thank you to Debbie and thank you to all the other cooks that used the recipes that I collated or curated for the new book, The New Dental Plate. So, what was there? What was there? So the spicy chicken soup is filled with biofilm busting foods and health promoting foods as well. So that's the whole tenet of the new dental plate, is that we can do more with food and ingredients and with an eye towards helping the whole body live better, that we can get periodontal disease and caries under control. What we're doing right now is all this surface stuff, which is fine, but the more I deep dive into the science, the more I'm realizing that caries and periodontal disease comes at a cellular level. It has nothing to do with the teeth. So stand by for more and more and more about that. So in this spicy chicken soup recipe is fresh ginger, 2 cloves of garlic, some lemon juice, chicken stock, chicken meat, chili paste, cilantro, sliced scallions, and a cup of baby spinach. That was really awesome and super, super duper simple. I mean, you didn't even have to boil this chicken to make the stock. I mean, it just came out of a container. Somebody did that for you. The peanut butter with the chocolate schmear on top, those are called fat bombs, and those are becoming more and more popular on ketogenic diets, where the main ingredient for the diet is FAT. So it looks like it's a high calorie food, but when you start cutting out the carbs, which is what's taking us to the grave, you will be so much better off, okay? So that's what's in there. So what is in there? It's peanut butter, coconut oil, and xylitol. So super simple. And then the, sorry, I still have some leaves in my teeth. So that's what makes that so good. Tart cherry juice lemonade, that was pretty good too. Water, tart cherry juice concentrate, which is completely 100% anti-inflammatory. It also has an effect on the oral biofilm in that it affects those early colonizers and doesn't allow a biofilm to start. So you're getting a double whammy with that. So you see tart cherry and you think lemonade and you're like, oh my God, they're going to erode their teeth. If they have saliva, they won't, right? The key ingredient here is saliva. And once you start incorporating these kind of foods, you're going to have a much healthier saliva as well. How about those spiced nuts? Again, it's helpful. It's an awesome dessert. I have it for dessert a lot. I took the first bite with the cayenne. I've never made it with the cayenne before. And I thought, you know, you don't even miss the chocolate. It has a really good mouthfeel, and it just is awesome. The cayenne is also anti-biofilm, okay? And it is also anti-cancer. So for oral cancer people and people who are having problems or having a high risk of oral cancer, you have a better chance of starting to quell that down. Once you start really looking at the diet and managing the diet well and looking into the past to get into the future, you will find that you're going to be doing more and more for your patients. We all had to take a semester of nutrition class, right? Okay, that wasn't enough. That was just enough to know how to spell some of the words. There's a lot that's going on with research in caries management with vitamin D supplements for childhood caries and for periodontal disease in grown-ups. It's crazy. And then you start to think, how many vitamins am I going to need to take? Right? And then you're thinking, this is what I'm thinking, the human body is going to evolve to just be a hole big enough for a pill and a straw. Because everybody's blending their food. Nobody's using their face. And that's the kind of thing that we're going to be talking about for the most part today. This is in my contract, my agreement with all speaking groups is to get rid of all of those effing noodles, pardon my French. Chicken with the skin on, you need to have some fat in order to stay full, you need to have good quality protein, you have to get away from the grains. The grains are really driving this whole thing downward. So this is too small to see, but if you were to hire me to speak at your meeting, you would get a copy that you could read. So, that's that. I just wanted to quickly talk a little tiny bit about that. And then just kind of open by talking about how much money are we throwing away on healthcare. It's costing an enormous amount of money. Enormous. It's sucking the life out of everybody. And there's so many preventive things that we can do that can really help move this needle in the other direction. So these are the four doctors that have really kind of turned my life around. I'm starting now, Philip. This is a short list, okay? There's many, many more, but these are the oldies. These are the ones who started thinking in a way that makes you wonder what happened. Dr. Evangeline Jordan was the first woman president of the Women in Dentistry organization back in the 1920s. We all know Dr. Foams. Dr. Price, I think we all know also. He was a dentist who went and sold his practice and sold everything about his practice so that he could find out why his patients were getting cavities and why his patients were having crooked teeth. He went down a rabbit hole. And Dr. Pottinger was not a dentist, but he found some amazing things as well. This is from Dr. Evangeline Jordan's book that she published in 1925. How close are we to 1925 right now? Pretty darn, or 2025. She was wondering back then, why are we doing this plugging of holes? Why is our profession permitting 60% to suffer needlessly? Dr. Pottinger was at about the same time working with these cats that showed up because he was doing a study on adrenal glands, and he was using a couple of cats, and he was, all of a sudden, everybody was dropping cats off at his doorstep. And he started to notice some things about this, the different cat groups that he was working with, and he started a little study. The study was based on four different kinds of foods. Every cat group had a base diet that was a normal cat-based diet, and then he manipulated the other two meals to include cooked meat instead of raw, and cooked milk instead of raw milk, and all the way to cooked meat and sweetened condensed milk. I would encourage you to write down his name and look it up on YouTube. It is the most alarming video you will ever see in your entire life. What he found in those cats was most astonishingly for this group is that their faces were melting. These cats in the fourth generation on this really inferior diet of cooked meat and condensed sweetened milk, in their if they had a fourth generation, the few leftover cats that were there, had no zygomatic arch, and their face was pushed in, okay, so it wasn't sticking out as far. They were lethargic, they lost interest in sex, they didn't have live births if they did manage to get a little thing together. So it was unbelievable, and it took four generations from then to get the cats to be back to health. There are some people who say we are in the fourth generation now of our poor, poor, poor diet, our inferior diet. A human generation is 20 years. So Dr. Price is the one who was a dentist and left his practice, and what he found globally, visiting tribes that had never been visited by the Westerners, he found beautiful, straight, strong teeth and no cavities. Nobody had diabetes, nobody had cavities, nobody had problems with their teeth. Strong, healthy bodies, and they were resistant to disease. They were eating foods that they had been eating for epochs, or epochs, however you want to pronounce it. So they were eating food that was native to them. They had emotional stability, they had an adherence to their traditional diet. The day the Western diet came in, they were starting to show signs of dental disease. So what he did up in the Eskimo land was, he was able to really track when Westerners came to different tribes, and he could tell which tribe had been infiltrated by this Western food. This is Western food from the 1920s and 30s. It's not what we have today. At least that food started out in good dirt. Today our dirt isn't even all that great. Dr. Fones, obviously, was wondering the same thing. And he learned that the bacteria on the teeth, right, are what was causing the problem. So he invented dental hygienic. And he said, scrape this junk off of the teeth. I don't want it here anymore. And look what happened to the world of dental hygiene. We're practically in charge of all diseases, and we're trapped in a dental office. Have you all known what's... Sometimes I wag my finger for no good reason. Sometimes it's a really good reason. But we've had some legislative yahoos and bell rings. Is everybody aware what's been happening in this crowd? Probably, because Linda's here. So as soon as she's done chewing, I will let her take a second and explain what's happening. Okay. So what's really been happening is closer to what Pottinger was finding than anything else. What's happened lately is that we have a shrinking face. Globally, malocclusion is skyrocketing and dental decay is skyrocketing in groups that have access to the standard American diet, the SAD. Standard American diet. You can see right here is a little piece of Dr. Mew, M-E-W. This is a still shot of a video on YouTube that he has. He has a lot of videos that you should definitely check out. And he here has the history of malocclusion. Dr. Mew is a third generation orthodontist in the UK. And he and his father and grandfather have been following this problem for a long time. He has a lot to say about what's been happening with occlusion and with dental crowding with respect to our food. And our food is where the epigenetic story starts to come in. Is everyone familiar with epigenetics? It's a little bit complicated, and I'm not really good at explaining it. So I have a video that's going to help us out with that. So if you know that DNA is DNA, it's what lights everything, right? Our diet and our stress level turn different parts of the DNA on and off, and that's called epigenetics, okay? So you have a genome that tells you you're going to have blue eyes or brown eyes or wrong color hair. I have to go and buy a different color hair. And so we have this situation where you have these certain characteristics. But based on what your grandmother experienced during her life, does other things to you. So my grandmother lived in Milwaukee, and at age 15, she was shipped with her family to a little backwards town where they had horses and buggies still, and no asphalt. They had dirt roads. They had to get golden dirt from the mountains to sprinkle on the floor to decorate the house. That was the decoration. It was completely opposite from her life in Milwaukee at age 15. So all the DNA she was carrying and all of her eggs were completely stressed out. So that gets transferred on to the eggs of her children, and then that gets passed on to the grandchildren. That was not a good explanation. So, that's why I have a video. Okay? Everybody hear it okay?
If you change the notes of Beethoven, you probably get a strange reaction. But you don't have to change a music score. change how it's expressed. And it's the same in our genes. You don't have to change the DNA itself to change how genes are expressed. Almost every cell in your body has the same DNA sequence. But of course, not all cells are the same. That's because different cells use the code in different ways. Stuff happens to the genes during development and through life. They're turned on and off depending on their jobs. A cell's combined set of all these changes is called its epigenome. The term epigenome describes changes that affect gene expression that aren't changes to the DNA itself, as sheep music. Epigenomic changes ensure that a heart cell is different to a brain cell, even though the code is the same. New work is helping to provide a reference of the epigenomic landscape in lots of different human cells. A fleet of scientists is trying to examine all these features as a way of understanding what cells do with their genetic code, and just how flexible it is, and what goes wrong in disease. Epigenomic changes are chemical tweaks to DNA, and to the proteins that package our DNA. They don't necessarily affect genes themselves, they affect particular regions of the code whose job it is to turn genes on or off. One much talked about change is methylation. This is when a chemical gets added to the DNA, and it primes a gene to be turned off. Another type of change has more to do with the arrangement of DNA. DNA isn't just in a big, long, endless line inside your cells. It's wrapped around proteins called histones. The configuration of these histone packages and how close together they sit can affect which genes are read and how many. Many changes to histone proteins, or to DNA methylation, are normal events in cell growth and development. When cells age, so there are still more changes to the epigenome. Some researchers have spotted an increase in methylation in older brains, for example. The environment, too, can affect the epigenome. Factors like what you eat, or if you smoke, or how much you exercise, can also influence the cell through epigenomic changes. Some diseases are linked with epigenomic changes too. Take cancer, for example, where cells replicate out of control. Here, scientists see rogue epigenomic changes. These changes are linked to genes behaving weirdly, genes being expressed that shouldn't be expressed, or genes shut off that usually keep cells in check. There are changes to the epigenome in other disorders too. Take Alzheimer's. One new study shows that even early in the condition, there can be changes to methylation in brain cells. It's still an open question whether these changes can trigger the disease. But if they do, that means that drugs that target the epigenome could one day slow the progression of Alzheimer's, or even help prevent it. Finally, cells can inherit not just the DNA, the sheep music, but the epigenomic changes too. They pass these on to the next generation of cells. Just like a Beethoven symphony, a cell's epigenome is complex and exquisitely arranged. Scientists are starting to understand how that arrangement changes in different cell types, during development, and in disease. And it's a performance. It's just beginning.
So that was a little easier, right? A little easier to understand. So everything that happens in the world to a person affects their DNA. And it does that by affecting these little histones. So the changes are extremely slow, and they are now considered to be normal because the changes had happened so slowly. These are a couple of slides from Dr. Kevin Boyd. And he was, he's a Darwinian dentist, if you can imagine. So what he's done is he has looked back at what has happened, and he's one of those why people. Why is all of this stuff happening? Why did Pottinger find what he found? What did Dr. Price found, and how does that relate today? And he too was wondering, why do we have so much crowding and so much decay? And what he's finding is that we have had changes. So we've had evolutionary changes that have happened so fast that it's only been 125 years or so. And when he talked to different evolutionary specialists, they told him this kind of change would take 10,000 years to happen. So let's say it's only half that bad. Let's say it takes 5,000 years. Hello, that's still a problem. So what he did is, in his presentation, this presentation is also on YouTube, he was reading this book, The Clinician Guides to Breastfeeding. This is for lactation consultants. And he was astonished to see that all babies are born with a small degree of retrognathia, or physiologic jaw retraction. This results in a relative posterior positioning of the base of the tongue, renders the newborn predominantly obligate breather, nasal breather. And he says, an unkind word right there. He doesn't believe that. When he goes back to skulls, fetal skulls and infant skulls, he was able to say that has never happened. This is a change that has happened recently, within the last 125 years. You can see here, this is a retrognathic fetus, okay? You can see it already in the womb. And that this is a change that is not helping anything happen. The lactation consultants are saying that this is a change that helps the baby pass through the birth canal. He says that the baby never passes through, that chin is never interfering with the baby's passage through the birth canal. That this is common, it is not normal, and it should not be viewed as normal. So we've had so many problems now that are considered normal, that are not normal, that it's almost impossible to write them all down. This is just one example. He studied hundreds and hundreds of skulls in different parts of the globe, and he's never ever found retrognathia in any skull. And then this paper comes along. Dr. Christian Guillemineau, he likes to say the L, but I can't make it come out of my mouth. Guillemineau is a researcher on pediatric sleep apnea. He has a lot to say about pediatric sleep apnea. And his conclusion in this paper is that pediatric sleep apnea in non-obese children is a disorder of oral facial growth. That is also huge. We can be more in charge of oral facial growth as dental hygienists when we're talking to our pregnant mothers. Maybe a little bit late then, but we can still do something at that stage. We can do that by helping the maxilla grow. Does everybody remember how gigantic the maxilla really is? That it's not just here, it's not just the palate. You can see in this picture, it's even holding up the eyeball. It's big. The way that it gets wide is how? The tongue. The tongue is what's pushing up against the palate. And that counteracts the facial muscles. The tongue needs to ride up on the palate for more than just increasing the size. So this was a paper I just stumbled across yesterday, and talks about the significance of the tongue on the spot and on the palate with relationship to heart rate variability. It's really important. When you think about the innervation of the palate, it's really crazy how everything kind of interrelates and interacts. when you go back, now the soft tissue doesn't really survive in these skulls, right? Because it's soft tissue. That'd be a real trick to get that to last. And what we've noticed now is that we have a lot more of these tongue ties than we ever thought, and that there's a bigger problem with the tongue tie than we ever thought. And that this airway problem may be a consequence of this tongue not getting up to the palate. And this retrognathic tongue is an epigenetic change. So we've got a couple of things kind of happening at the same time. I know it sounds a little bit confusing. So this is a mouth-breathing child, right? And this is a mouth-breathing adult. How many of us see mouth breathers? And then what do we say? Breathe with your nose. You tell them how? They don't know how. Never occurred to me they wouldn't know how. Just, there are a lot of reasons why they can't breathe through their nose. One of the reasons is a small palate, is a small maxilla. Think about this other side of the maxilla, the non-dental side of the maxilla. Where is it? It's in the sinuses. So if you have a small maxilla because the tongue's not reaching up there, or because you're feeding with a bottle, or you're not using your teeth, what's with all this blender stuff, smoothies and stuff? It's crazy. It's all affecting right away the infant as they're growing. And if they start doing the smoothie stuff along with their parents, that's going to be an epigenetic change that's going to convert into a smaller yet palate in the next generation or two. So you can see this is going really fast. And it's because of our awesome technology. Gotta love technology. This is a tongue tie. These are examples of tongue ties. In Brazil, they are so hilarious about tongue ties. I can't get these right on time. That they have a national law that forces every medical practitioner to do an evaluation of a tongue tie on a newborn infant. It's that important and that big of a deal. Now this is a normal tongue. This is a tongue that's tied anteriorly, right? So they still have some movement, but it's tied more towards the front. This is a short frenum or frenulum, depends on what school you go to, I guess. You can have a short anterior one and you can have an absolutely tied tongue. Now, the thing about these absolutely tied tongues is that we have a very high tolerance for tongue tie in dentistry. It's super high. This person has a completely ankylosed tongue and they're already on their second set of teeth and nobody's done anything. Okay? Same over here, same over here. You can see that there's fillings in these people's mouths. There's been dentistry in there. But nobody has done anything with the tongue. I still do chairside dental hygiene, and it's amazing to me how things just come in clumps. Is everybody else amazed by that too? I'm like, why do I have 3 ankylosed adults in 4 days, and then like 5 other ties in a short period of time? And then, you know, it'll be nobody for a couple weeks. This is out there, it needs to be done. When I brought it to the attention of the dentist, what did the dentist say? He's fine. You got along this long without it. You really want me to cut that thing for you? Because I can. I'll cut it for you. If you want me to, I'll cut it. You know, I'm like, shut up. That's what I wanted to do. I don't do a lot of things I want to do, just so you know, just for the record. And then I was talking to an airway dentist in the same group, and he's like, well, Shirley, what, doesn't this keep the tongue out of the airway? I'm like, no. Think of it this way, those stress balls with sand in them, if you tip them back, like the tongue, it'll just slide back and it'll just close off the airway. Not only that, it will create a weird occlusion pattern. And you can't count on any of the occlusion patterns. It could be a deep bite, it could be a complete overbite, it could be an open bite, it can be a lot of different things depending on how that person is compensating. So let's take a look at this little video here.
Airway and TMJ.
And see how all this goes together.
The normal way to breathe is through your nose. As we grow and develop, certain things such as pollen, cow milk, and other variables can cause an allergic reaction, causing the lymphoid tissues known as tonsils and adenoids to become swollen. As the tonsils and adenoids become swollen, they develop into an obstruction for nasal breathing, and slowly, mouth breathing begins to be the primary intake of air into the body. In order to breathe through the mouth, the lower jaw comes down, the tongue comes off the palate, and settles on the lower teeth. Nasal breathing is the correct way for air to enter the body, and during nasal breathing, the tongue rests at the palate and the pressure of the cheeks is balanced by the tongue. During mouth breathing, the pressure from the cheeks is unopposed by the tongue. The oral system becomes unbalanced and results in the deformation of the upper jaw, creating a V-shaped arch as opposed to a correct U-shaped arch. This also produces an incorrect swallowing function. Upon swallowing, the tongue rests on the lateral teeth, hindering normal tooth eruption, causing a lateral tongue thrust. A constantly open mouth causes the incisors to over-erupt. The result is a deformation of the lower arch known as the bicuspid drop-off. The result of this deformation of the upper and lower arches is the presence of premature contacts upon closing, which shift the lower jaw distally off of the physiologic trajectory. The narrowing of the upper arch pushes the lower jaw back. This forces the TMJ condyle to shift distally while the TMJ disc shifts forward. Upon opening, the disc can shift onto the condyle to restore the TMJ's correct position, reduction of the disc, and then shift back to an incorrect forward position upon closing. This is what causes a reciprocal click. In addition, the muscles could be in a state of hypertonus or spasm, which can result in tension headaches. An incorrect position of the lower jaw can result in parafunctional activity of the muscles, such as clenching and grinding. Over time, grinding can result in severely worn down teeth. As a result, the teeth become even shorter, the lower jaw shifts distally even further, and the vertical of the bite decreases. In time, joint degeneration occurs. The joint becomes deformed, and the ligaments of the joint become damaged. As a result, the TMJ disc can get trapped in front of the condyle. While the click may go away, limited mouth opening will occur. Distally shifted jaw and tongue positions result in even further restriction of the airway. In order to open up the airway, the neck moves forward and the head tilts backward. This stresses the spine and fatigues the neck muscles, which results in neck, back, and shoulder pain.
This video is also available on YouTube. So it's Dental Art 3D Airway TMJ. I think if you just search Airway TMJ, you'll find it. So we need to have the tongue up on the palate in order for everything to function right. Everything is really dependent on the tongue. And that kind of brings us to this idea of homeostasis and the idea that everything's not a teeter-totter. It's not just a balancing act. It's spherical. It's round. It's like even a balloon. You squeeze one spot and another spot goes big and the wrong spot gets narrow, and it's crazy how everything interacts and everything interrelates. So you can't just say, you know, there's a teeter-totter, get rid of the plaque in your mouth and everything will be fine. No, that won't, it may not be fine. This is, let's get this one. So we're gonna do a little test now about your tongue, your own tongue ties. So this is the test that we do at Primal Air to assess a tongue at the first visit. And we have the patient, you can do this real easy with your patients during your oral cancer screening. You have them open their mouth as wide as they can without hurting their jaw. and then bring the tip of their tongue to the spot just behind the upper front teeth. So it goes like this. And the mouth should not close more than 50%. So in this example, the mouth is not closing more than 50%. So open as wide as you can, because they're doing that anyway, right? And then lift your tongue to the spot. Check your neighbor. Come on, pair up a little bit. Are you anybody tied in here? Super easy. Super easy. Now in this person, it looks like it could be tight, because this is really tight right here, right? But it's really not impeding her feature, how she's functioning. Okay? You may still end up opening that up or closing it up, whichever you want to call it. Breathing is also being scrutinized. Nasal breathing is primary, and we want it to be the only way to breathe. I took my breathing retraining classes, and I was talking to my son that lives in the California mountains, and he bikes in those mountains multiple times a week. He does a 50-mile loop. I don't even remember all the details anymore. 50-mile loop in 90 minutes, I think it was what it was.
Yes.
Yeah, in the mountains with a 2,000-foot climb over time, right? Good boy, that's what I said. And then he calls me, he goes, I closed my mouth the whole way, and I got off my bike, and I thought my odometer was wrong. I'm like, what are you talking about? He goes, what happened is that I got off my bike, and I felt more energy than I ever thought I would have after doing that. I felt like I could go around again. That's because he maintained proper oxygenation of his muscles. He wasn't hyperventilating. So let's take a quick minute to talk about breathing for a second and just put this in context with this tiny little palate that's happening. So at rest, you should take somewhere between 8 and 10 in and out through your nose. You breathe about 5 liters per minute, and this is driven by the diaphragm. It should be silent, and your shoulders should be still. And you shouldn't be doing that. You shouldn't, you know, shouldn't be having any twisting and no noise. We need to deliver oxygen to the body cells, and we need to remove excess CO2. Turns out the CO2 is what's driving the whole equation. Okay? CO2 is produced by the body, and it's stored in the blood and in the lungs. Okay? Carbon dioxide is produced from exercising, from your cells, from your muscle cells, right, and from digestion. So you want to get rid of your CO2, but not too much, because if you get rid of too much, that throws everything off, and then you overbreathe, and then you hyperventilate. The CO2 then triggers the breathing, which is activated in the medulla. Can't read that at all. There are consistent messages. If there are consistent messages of low CO2, the medulla itself starts to lower the breathing ceiling. So now you feel like you need to breathe more and more. The carbon dioxide is what's in the blood that releases the oxygen to get off the red blood cell into the tissue. So that's what was happening to him. He had enough carbon dioxide stuck by not breathing, right, by keeping his mouth closed, by not offloading too much CO2. So he had enough carbon dioxide on board to release more oxygen from his red blood cells so that it could get into his tissue. And that's why he felt so good. There's a pH that's also involved here, and it's really hard when you're mouth breathing to maintain this pH. That's why our patients that snore, and who, the children who snore, and the ones who just breathe with their mouth open, have a lower pH in their mouth, and they have a higher chance for decay, a higher risk for decay. That's common. complicated. So carbon dioxide prevents the smooth muscle also from going into spasm. This is one of the mechanisms why they're thinking that mouth breathing in children is keeping them in a wet bed, that they're unable to manage their smooth muscle. We have over 300 kilometers of cardiovascular system, and with carbon dioxide, we have potential for some spasm. The major cause of shortness of breath is what we call asthma, and which is what this whole Buteyko breathing system was developed to counteract, is an overbreathing, a gasping for air, an inflated need for air that is, it's fake. It's a faux need for air. Because there's plenty of oxygen, it just can't be released because you're offloading too much of the carbon dioxide. They call that hypocapnia. So the blood then is holding all of this, and they're likening it to this this idea that the blood has kind of a carbonated system happening. It's hard to imagine your blood as being carbonated, but that's pretty much what it is. And when you're breathing with your mouth open, you're releasing that carbonation, and then you can imagine that your blood goes flat, that the soda goes flat. Isn't that terrible? I'm sorry. It's a hard concept, and so I struggle with this all the time. But the blood does effectively lose all of its, if you're overbreathing or breathing with your mouth open, you're not retaining the carbon dioxide. And then that's what is causing the hyperventilation syndrome. Almost nobody knows they're hyperventilating. Almost nobody. So, mouth breathing in children, they have a low fizz in the blood, you can call it that. So, breathe with your mouth closed. Now, what happens if they have tonsils? What happens if their adenoids are in the way? What happens if they have a cold and they have to breathe with their mouth open? What if their maxilla is so small that there's just not enough air that can come in through their nose? Then that's the next level. But we want to get them to breathe properly in the first place. I have a patient who has an anterior open bite, and she's got a minor tongue tie, and actually it was a really kind of hard to diagnose that it was even a tie. And looking at her pictures again, I noticed that her nares are very small. She's not been breathing through her nose almost her whole life, and she's like 15 now. So even things like talking too fast and yawning. My dad sighs all the time. He's 80-something years old now, and he's just always like sounding like he's out of breath. And if he would just keep his mouth shut, it would be a whole other story. So this whole mouth breathing thing really needs to have another level of address. Hypocapnia prevents the pH of the arterial blood then from reaching optimal levels. So Weston A. Price Foundation meeting a couple of months ago, maybe it's 2 months now, and they were arguing about blood saturation and the pH of blood and how tight of a tolerance there is for blood pH. And I was like, but you can screw that up by mouth breathing. Oh no, you can't. Oh no, you can't. Well, you can. So we want to increase the saturation of the O2. We need to increase that carbon dioxide, and the easiest way you can do that is by closing your mouth. Now, what they also taught us in this class was something that I was avoiding like the plague, and that was taping your mouth shut at night. So, that's what I do now. They talked me into it. I don't respond well to a lot of different things, and so I have been able to find a little bit of relief in some kind of weird way. What was happening is because of dental hygiene and typing, my neck is not curved. Not only is it not curved, it's curved crooked. It's curved the opposite direction. So you're shaking your head. You're familiar with that. So I've been going to the chiropractor every couple of weeks, and she uses her little activator, and she pushes and she does stuff to it. And she's got me where, well, she's told me and she sold me a gadget to wear under my neck so that I could replace that curve when she's not banging on it. And of course, I can't seem to find the time to to lay on this gadget. But the 2-year x-rays showed that there was already improvement, and that I haven't had, that I've also had improvement in the arthritis in my neck. But that crooked neck is keeping me from keeping my mouth shut. I was laying in bed and I was like, okay, why is my mouth open? Because I just closed it, and it just like pops open. Bing! And I thought, well, I don't know what I was thinking, and I just jammed a pillow behind my head. And I thought, well, let's see what happens. And it slammed shut when I was hyperextended like that. And I thought, well, there you go. I can't help it. So 3M MicroPore tape. It's the fastest, cheapest way to stop snoring in your home. 3M MicroPore tape, 1 inch. You can breathe through it, which I do, because I'll peel my lips apart. But, and it's not because I'm looking for oxygen. It's not because I'm suffocating at all. I get plenty of air through my nose, plenty. But it's a structural thing, and then I'm breathing through my mouth. Your patients are breathing that way as well. Your patients who are complaining about dry mouth, especially in the morning, may be very well with that tape. There's a pediatrician in Chicago who uses, who recommends tape for all of her patients over 4 years old that have any kind of a sleep problem. She does it this way. I've tried it this way, it doesn't do any good. Yep, I gotta do mine all the way across. She says some of the kids, they'll rip it. Look at her, she's just dying back there. Philip, you're not taking any pictures of these people reacting to my story.
I got it.
He's got it. So sometimes you can just rip off a little tiny piece and get away with it. The whole point is to keep it together. The secondary point is for proprioception, so that your lips get used to being together. Okay? That's another key piece here. So we need to put more fizz in the blood. I think we're done with the fizz in the blood thing. So this is the exercise now. This is how we test, and this is how you can test how healthy your patients are. So this is called the control pause. And if you are reading the book, The Oxygen Advantage, it's also called the BOLT score, the body oxygen level test. So right now, just keep breathing with your mouth closed and just breathe normal. And when you yawn, take an extra couple of breaths and normal breathing. And then at a certain point, not right now, I'm going to ask you to hold one of your hold both your nostrils closed and start to count off some seconds. And then after a time, maybe 10 seconds, it might be 50 seconds, you're going to take your hand away from your nose and you're going to take a breath in. Okay? So at your next exhale, plug your nose and start counting. There's a little second hand over there too if you're a bad counter. Seems like I can't get past 11. I lose track. The healthier you are, the longer your CP. So we want your control pause or your BOLT score to be as close to 40 as possible. So if it's 10 or less, you should probably stop at the emergency room on your way out. Would it be better? Well, it just shows your overall health level. And by practicing doing these breath holds under different conditions, you can learn to have a longer and longer breath hold. And in that way, you're going to get healthier and healthier. We know through studies that people that have high or have really low CP scores, have a higher incidence of cardiovascular diseases, diabetes, asthma, and the whole list. And you can also match these scores with the ASA score. So 10 and less would be an ASA 4. And then a CP of 40 would be an ASA 1. So there we go. Less than 20, you might find that you have a blocked nose, you might find that you have insomnia or fatigue, breathlessness. Anything between 20 to 40, you may not have any symptoms, or you may initiate one pretty easily. So here is the here are the studies listed. This is from normalbreathing.com. And look at the control causes of the people who are super sick. So chicken and egg again. We don't know which came first right now, but we do know that there's a correlation. So if you remember your ASA scores, here they are. So symptoms reduce with every 5-second CP improvement. I was able to get one of our clients, you know, aside of my bicycling son, he was over 60 seconds with his control pause. He came to me with a tongue tie. He would not have it released because God put it there. But he was able to reduce his anxiety severely. He was able to dramatically reduce his anxiety, and he was able to get rid of all of that tingly pins and needles kind of feeling, and he was able to do that control pause for 70 seconds. So it's possible. So this is a video of how important it is to get the these problems addressed at the earliest stage possible. I'm sorry there's no narrative. you can see that he also had his tongue tie released. Yes, ma'am?
We have a patient at our office that works at Luther Hospital. She's a nurse, which is one of the hospitals here at Mayo. And they are checking the children right away. And if they have a restricted lingual frenum or tongue tie, they are having it done before they leave the hospital.
Newborns you're talking about?
Newborns.
Nice.
Because of the lactation, they're not able to latch on or having the sucking problems, and also knowing that they can have breathing problems and things like that. So they're now are evaluating it.
That's
so we
awesome.
Just found that out a couple months ago.
That's really
talking
awesome.
About it. Yeah.
So it's much more prevalent than before, and they're thinking it has a lot to do with not just recognizing it, but because of this methylation issue with the epigenetics, that we may be seeing more because we're not using our tongue right, or because of the food or whatever all, but that's what they're thinking. So don't let your patients keep having these tongue ties. We practice in Sun Prairie, and we see a lot of patients virtually. We use the internet, we use the whole teledentistry kind of application there, and we teach them how to use the muscles in their face. This was a study here looking at the oropharyngeal exercises on snoring, and concluded that the exercises were effective in reducing objectively measured snoring and are a possible treatment for large population suffering from snoring. Here we go again with moderate obstructive sleep apnea syndrome from 2009. And they randomized the patients into exercises and not, and they found decreases in even things like neck circumference, snoring frequency, sleep quality score, and severity of sleep apnea. They were able to reduce the sleep apnea by 50% in this study, and in children it was over 60%. Sleep apnea, this was the review that showed, boy, that does not show up this light. Showing that these exercises can really help with sleep apnea by improving the, this is the one here, 50% adults and 62% children, by just working through these myofunctional techniques. Mandibular advancement devices versus CPAP and the treatment, and they're finding that they are pretty much equal. There are problems with both. The dental appliances, is there anybody doing dental appliances for sleep in here? Are you finding any problems with TMJ in those clients at all? TMJ issues, and some half of them have TMJ problems. So there's still no good answer for sleep apnea. Sleep apnea can cause obesity, so the whole lose weight and stop snoring kind of thing is kind of a backward circle. It throws off the complete hunger and satiety hormone system there. It's just not, it's a really insidious disease that continues to just find its tentacles everywhere. So this study here showed that they both work, but they're not really good answers. Preschool children with obstructive sleep apnea, the beginnings of elevated blood pressure. So these little children that we see that are snoring and isn't that cute is not really cute. It's a cry for help. There's a problem. There's a big, big problem. 128 kids between 3 and 5 years, and then they had 35 kids in the control. Given that increased blood pressure during childhood predicts hypertension in adulthood, longitudinal studies are needed to determine the effect of resolution of snoring in OSA at this age. So we want to do something for these kids. This is the Garrelin leptin story here, and how snoring complicates weight problems. So not only are you going to snore if you have more weight, but snoring increases your weight because the hormones are off. You're just more hungry, and you never get the full signal. We have the ADHD problem and the ADD problem. This was the prevalence here between 2011 and 2012. It's about 1.5 million school kids. And the amount of medication is pretty severe. This is putting huge pressure onto our healthcare system. This is the cost study from, I think it was 2009, and they looked at education, parental work loss, and juvenile justice system costs, and they found $42.5 billion was spent on ADHD-related dramas. And they considered those to be preliminary studies. It's continuously throwing money away when we have some other better answers. We have obstructions that range from tongue tie all the way down to adenoids and tonsils and the small palate, even things like allergies and colds. Sometimes after you have a cold, it takes a few days after the cold is done to get your mouth shut again. So all the kids that you see, teach them even how to blow their nose. That is definitely in the dental hygienoscope practice. And gargle. Gargle. So this is a way while you're doing your... that can be used while you're doing your oral cancer screening as well. This is the Friedman Palate score. Okay, there are two main scores, the Friedman and the Mallampati. I find both of them a little bit useful and surprising that they don't match, so it's probably best to do both. So this one has the tongue inside the mouth. The Mallampati score, which you're going to hear more and more about, is with the tongue out. Okay. So what we're looking at is how much room is back here. I never thought I would ever see anybody like this, and now I see almost everybody like this. It's crazy. Is anybody else doing these kind of evaluations on their patients? You're like, dude, how do you get any air at all? Because it's plugging up the hole with the tongue going backwards, too. So this is very common in people that have had ortho extractions, too, because now there's nowhere for the tongue. And then they say you have megaloglossia. Ms. Schwartz told us there was no such thing. It's a high narrow palate. It could be because the tongue wasn't there. I used to just think, oh, you were probably a thumb sucker. And then they would say, no, I wasn't. And then I'm like, okay, then what happened? Because you can put your thumb right in there. It's just exactly that big. It might have a lot to do with the tongue tie. This is a low and anterior tie. This is before and after the release. You can see how free that is. This is pre and post tongue tie release in an orthodontist office. Dr. Bill Hang is a pretty big cheese in the ortho world. He does something called orthotropics, and he routinely replaces missing teeth with implants. So he brings the whole maxilla forward, he brings somehow the mandible forward, and he regains that space that was lost from having those teeth out. And his patients are in seventh heaven. This I'm not even going to go through because these were just utterances from a website of people that had, of this woman that had her tongue tie released. This is, I'm sorry, I've got so many videos, but it's really so much easier to explain if you hear from the horse's mouth here. This is a patient of Dr. Payne. This is him. And he has a patient that he's working on with Joy Moeller, who is the person who taught me. And he has been treating this woman with his orthotropics and regaining the space that she had lost from having teeth out. And so this is the day after she had her tongue tie release done. And you can tell she's over 40. Come on, Bill, Stop talking.
Profound. I noticed an immediate sense of release and relief. A half an hour after the procedure, I noticed it was so much easier for me to swallow. I had no idea how difficult it was for me to swallow my whole life. And yesterday, with my tongue swollen and stitches, I can swallow. And my shoulders are just relaxing and hanging, and there's just no more of this internal tension or grinding, and I can breathe, and my lips are just relaxed. I've been coating my braces and the coils with wax because my lips have just been kind of like stuck to them, but there's no wax on my braces. It's just relaxed and nice, and I feel like I've taken the strongest muscle relaxant in the world. And I've taken Flexerols recently due to an auto accident, and I feel like I've taken 10 of them.
That much relief.
That much relief. And my shoulders are actually kind of sore because they're not held up, and I didn't realize that every time I turned my neck, it was the internal tissue pulling on my shoulders, because now I can swallow, and I'll get this. Every time I stick my tongue out, I want to cry, because that used to bring up this internal feeling. I can't explain it, but it's so easy now. I can move my tongue without feeling tense and tight, and I'm going to go like get a massage, because I just feel like all droopy and relaxed, and like, you know, 40 years of tension is just now kind of like melting away.
Thank you.
And then I can swallow. Like, and I've been in myofunctional therapy, and the more I was doing tongue exercises with Joy, like the tension, I was getting headaches and all this stuff, and it was like really coming to a head. And she would have me put my tongue on the spot,
yes,
grin and swallow back here with the back of my tongue on the roof of my mouth, and I couldn't do it. It was such an effort. And just putting my tongue on the spot was, I could feel the tension in the back of my head, and now it's like, it's not problem. And I've been drinking and eating, and I ate dinner last night, and I was tired afterwards. I didn't realize how much energy I was exerting just eating. Okay.
Thank you.
And that's what the swollen tongue stitches in my mouth. I couldn't be more thrilled.
Isn't that crazy? This is probably the best one. There are others on there, on the internet there, on YouTube, of people that are doing the same kind of talk. They're just so excited, so relieved. And there's one that I play every now and then by Dr. Copley in East Berlin, Pennsylvania, a patient of hers, that she was 27, and she thought she was just a teacher, and she's just holding all of her pressure like this, you know. And once her tongue tie was released, it was like instantaneous relief. So don't be afraid. They are petrified. I have not yet talked to an adult that needed a tongue tie that was like petrified. I don't understand it. I really don't. I don't say surgery anymore, because the first time I did, the poor kid just about flipped out. And I was like, well, it's surgery like a filling is surgery. So don't be afraid of that. Now let's talk about another way to get another example of a restriction of the airway. So this is the cracker swallow test that we do. It's not a test. This is one of the exercises that we do. I'm sorry. For our clients. So they do a week of this particular exercise, and it's to get the tongue to manipulate and to be where we need it to be when we're eating and swallowing. So don't touch the cracker yet. So I'm going to explain the whole thing, then we're going to do it, because otherwise you'll screw it up. We'll have to start over, and I'll have to make comments about it. So you're going to take the cracker flat, and you're going to put it in your mouth flat like a host, and then you're going to push up with your tongue against your palate, and you're going to break the cracker in half like this. Then you're going to chew the cracker for 20 chews, and then you're going to, without swallowing, you're going to get 20 chews, then you're going to kind of gather it into your tongue, and then you're going to put your tongue to the palate with your tongue the way we did the little test earlier. So you have the cracker paste on your tongue. Your tongue now is at the tip, at the spot behind your upper front teeth. You're going to go like that and swallow. So you may want to take a sip of water first, because it is the driest cracker in the world. It's a salty. So, so go ahead and put the, once you're done with your sip of water there, put it in flat, the whole thing. Push your tongue up against the roof of your mouth so that the cracker snaps in half. And then start chewing and count to 20. Don't swallow it, can help it in between. And then when you get to 20, kind of gather the cracker mush on your tongue. Put the tongue tip at the spot, teeth together, lips apart, and swallow. We have a winner, winner, chicken dinner. Good job. Do you have a lot of cracker left over? A little bit? Everybody do okay? Anybody have any big problems with that? Here's Patty.
Can you get the lights on?
Until you need dentures, let's just leave it. I'm like, It's not normal. It shouldn't be there. It's not normal. It shouldn't be there. So we used to say that this was a problem, right? The thick neck, got a collapsed airway. Look at this little spot right here. There is no air at all for this guy. No air at all. Kids who are snoring in their sleep, we don't even look. We don't take an x-ray. We don't take a Ceph on these kids. The orthodontist takes a PAN. That doesn't really show anything. But every Ceph that I get from the dentist who sends me patients, every one, I look at their airway and I look at their neck to see what's happening. This, they tell us, is the gold standard. This is why people don't even tell you they're snoring, because they don't want that. This was Anton Scalia, who died last February. This is his obituary from the Washington Post. It says that he had an obsession with detail. If you're from here, get an obsession with details. This was astonishing to me. On his nightstand next to him, unplugged and not turned on, was his CPAP machine. And then the obituary went on to say, oh, well, maybe he forgot. And I'm like, his wife wasn't there, so there was nobody there to nag him into wearing it. That's what I think is the real story. And then people are like, oh, well, he was drinking heavily, blah, blah, blah. He wasn't wearing a CPAP. And this is what we call our gold standard. I think that's a problem. It's not a good answer. We need to pay more attention to these ties. This kid doesn't have teeth yet, but he's obviously having a problem. This is a telltale sign. So when they stick their tongue out, you'll see this little heart shape here. Or when they lift their tongue, it'll look kind of like a whale tail. Sleep-disordered breathing in children is a sleepiness problem and a behavior problem. Kids who are tired twitch in school to stay awake. They bother their neighbor, they smart mouth, they get any little twitch of adrenaline that they can get. And then they get kicked out of the class, and then they go sit out in the hall for 10 minutes, and then they miss the important part of the lesson. And then they get kicked out of the class again, and then on and on it goes until they just stop going. Then it's just, why bother? This here was a study of hyperactivity and snoring too. More symptoms of the snoring kids had significantly more symptoms of hyperactivity, even off the shores of the United States. Symptoms of snoring peak at 30 months, 40 to 100% increase in neurological behavior. Neurobehavior morbidity by age 7 in the kids who snore. I don't understand why we have to keep having these giant ranges, because it makes it hard to really say this is it or that's it. This is probably the most important one here, impaired executive function. That's the piece that helps you realize you got pulled over because you were speeding, not because you were wearing a red shirt. Okay, that's the part that says, I got sent to the principal's office because I was bad in class and didn't do my homework or didn't turn it in or whatever. That's the piece that's missing and underdeveloped in these kids. That's the biggest problem that I think. So, intraoral pH and temperature also are altered during sleep with the mouth open. Okay. It may be a causal factor for dental erosion and caries. You can't brush that away. I remember when I started speaking, I came across a mother who had posted on a site that her child's oral pH in the morning was 3. I was like, dude, you can't brush that away. There's something else that's happening. I also wrote to Drs. Featherstone and Young and said it's time to update the caries balance. And I said we have to start adding structural components, because this is a situation that's primed for caries, because everything's going to get trapped there. Right? And Dr. Featherstone said, we need more studies. And I was like, Are we ever going to have enough studies that fluoride is going to finally get kicked off this list? Every year there's another 70 or 100 studies on fluoride. We're never going to have enough studies of anything else. Right? There's no money in it. Obstructive sleep apnea does not negatively affect oral health. Oh, here we go. So we've got the other person, the other side is heard from. So age and the duration of snoring complaints were positively correlated with decayed missing and failed teeth index, while educational status and income levels were negatively correlated. So they did and they didn't. The thing is that we can reduce some of these problems by using xylitol. Xylitol nasal spray is being actively sought out by myofunctional therapists and other airway practitioners to reduce the size of the adenoids and the tonsils. So, I've never done this before. Well, that's not true. I did it earlier this afternoon. I'm going to have you all take out your xylitol nasal spray in this snippy new package and open it up. Now, Trish O'Hare has been doing this for years. She hasn't lost a patient or an audience member yet, so we're doing it. This is the bottle. This is the cooler bottle. Both of these bottles have anti-suckback stuff. So this bottle here is $15, but you can get three bottles that resemble this for $15 to fill that up. So, once you've got, yeah, they got a new cap tightener, I think, Linda. I couldn't get mine open either.
Yeah,
you got the plastic off, right?
One with the plastic thing.
Oh, you don't have one with the plastic on?
Here's one right here.
I can't hear.
I'm like, you start picking off plastic, and I don't have to. Mine's open, and half you is
here. Oh, this is so hard to open once you get the plastic.
Hey, first, everybody. Once you get it, is there anybody in here who has never used the xylitol nasal spray before? It took me 3 years to talk myself into that. Okay, this is their flagship product, and all I could talk about was the gum and the mints because I just hated the idea of squirting something in my nose. Eight. Can't you get it open?
It's really nice.
Three tries? They have to let them know. They have to give a little less juice to their screwdriver thing. All right, so. Don't waste another 3 years. And I know that you've at least known about this for 3 years, because I was here at least 3 years ago. So, this is it. So give it a squeeze so you can see what's going to happen. Okay? A big bubble? I'll squeeze it again.
Don't keep squeezing.
There you go. Just see how it goes. Then you just put one side closed, squeeze it, and breathe in at the same time.
Oh.
Sometimes, if you're really good, you can do two squeezes. I'm advanced now. Then do the other side. So, shortly, you will feel it going down the back of your throat.
So am I. I'm a pro at that.
So how was it? How was it? Can you feel it? Is it going down your throat yet? So, in RDH magazine recently, Amber Auger wrote an article about using xylitol for your patients before you lean them back. Once you get their nasal sinus, once you get their sinuses clean, they don't choke and gag as much, and their tongue doesn't bite as hard, because now they can breathe. Okay? So there's a neat little tip for you. So I think you can get as many of these little samples as you want for your favorite price. So call over there and find out. Plus, if you notice, there's a $3 off coupon on the back here. Okay. So we already did that. So what else can we do for our patients that are breathing with their mouth open and they're at risk for decay? Is we can start to apply some products to their teeth at home and in the office. So we have, this is the Remin Pro. This is by Voco. We also have MI Paste. MI Paste is really helpful because it has a really long substantivity. So this is something that you can do for them when they're at home, while you're waiting for them to decide to get their tongue tied released, to have a procedure to have their tongue tie released. Okay? In the office, we can use Novamin powder now. You all have some materials here from Silk. So if you remember, we used to have a product called Novamin, and then we had a product called Silk, which was just powdered Novamin. And this has been very helpful in remineralizing teeth real time in your chair right now, boom, with an air polisher. So this was a study that was done when they were trying to see if it was helpful or not. Minimally invasive caries removal using a bioactive glass air abrasion, and they found that, yes indeed, it did work. It was as good as aluminum, and actually better because it stopped at the end of the decay. It had a self-limiting action. So that was a huge plus, okay? So when you're doing your sealants, air polishing is superior to any other way of cleaning those pits and fissures, and then cleaning them with a bioactive glass is even better. So we are able now to use Silk again. It went away. Remember, it had that one cool little bottle that looked kind of like a bowling pin? So now it's not in a bowling pin thing. It's in a much better container. And I have two samples right here. Do you have an air polisher here at the school?
We will in June.
In June? Oh, awesome. So I'll leave the rest of them with you.
Do we have air polishers? I'm thinking about the digital air polishers.
No. Good, so I'll leave you one of these and then stop and see if I have any left over at the end of the silk. So this is a really awesome way to do minimally invasive procedures from the dental hygienist chair. Okay, you can remineralize root surfaces, you can clean out areas of decay, and you can stop the decay in real time. Okay, completely remediable. And this is the new AquaCare unit. This is how the silk comes to go into this unit. And it doesn't use electricity, so there's one less hose. Woo-hoo-hoo! And then that cassette just drops right in here. This is the most ugliest foot pedal in the world, but this is the thing that makes it go. It just runs off of air pressure. The thing that really happens and why people hate air polishing so much is because of the plume, because it's so messy. But what you need to do, and what almost nobody tells you to do, is to turn the air pressure way down, like way down to like 30. Okay, that's all you really need for an air polisher. It makes the tea slippery. This is what you look like when you're sleeping with tape on your mouth. We also have a couple of studies looking to see if asthma is the reason or if asthma also contributes to this hyperactivity, okay, and behavioral problems. And they found that sleep disordered breathing is separate in this behavior outcomes than asthma is. So you're much better. Asthma doesn't affect behavior the same way that sleep disordered breathing does. Here's another one. Oh, this is the same one here. Asthma was much less clear as a predictor for positive behavior outcomes in girls, but not boys. Here's another case. This was a case study of a 17-year-old boy, slender, which is another indicator for upper airway restriction or upper airway resistance syndrome. Okay? So all these little tiny skinny ladies that have a long list of problems and you think to yourself, how big is her airway? And you think to yourself, it's this big, right? Very often it's the slender ones that have this big, these bigger airway problems. They're more insidious. So this kid was 17 years old. He was diagnosed with ADHD, and somnolence was tiredness, often abated somewhat with the use of antibiotics for sinusitis, which was attributed to his sinus infection. A later sleep study revealed sleep apnea, and through additional testing, proved that the original ADHD diagnosis was an error. But he still took those pills, and now he's stuck on a CPAP machine. Ethnic differences, seems like there's always a little bit of a difference with ethnic backgrounds, or I don't know if there's a non-racist way to say it. Those of the black race, prematurity are independent predictors of snoring. So for some reason, they have a higher incidence. Breastfeeding, let's not forget the breast. We think about the milk all the time. Huge. We think about the milk all the time, but it's the complete package that needs to be in effect. That's how you can tell. That's how you can tell that the whole mechanism is going to work. You need the tongue not only to press against the palate, but at birth, you need the breast in between there to also improve pressure up against the palate. That also helps stimulate the growth of the palate. So we're very much concerned about giving breast milk to the babies, but we still leave the hospital. Who just had a baby recently? Did they send you home with formula? They're just twitching to get that plug in that kid's mouth. Did they also send you home with that horrible green pacifier? Did you throw away? Yes. So, you know, we do need to get a premium on breastfeeding. We need to really rethink how we're doing this, even here in this country, because it's affecting the overall health in everybody, even from a structural perspective. And then we have the thumb suckers. First of all, they're not sucking their thumb for security. They're very often sucking their thumb because there's an airway issue. And holding their tongue down with their thumb is opening their airway somehow. Okay. And then this was a picture that I stole from a Facebook group of a mother who got her daughter to stop sucking her thumb at age 3. And 2 weeks after, you could already see that there's an improvement in the teeth. And look what happened 3 months later. It's almost completely closed. And she posted another picture a year later that was completely resolved. So her teeth are resolved, but is that the reason she was sucking her thumb? Is the problem still there? Is she compensating in another way? So those are the kinds of things we have to wonder about. This is a crazy study that I came around the other couple weeks ago, I guess, about cola beverages and the alveolar bone and the maxillary bone and how cola beverages interfere. Now, I don't know that it's that big of a problem here, but when you go to third world countries, all the kids have a straw in a bag with Coke in it. I do not get that. I don't know what the advertising is down there for that, but you see it very, very often. So, you know, we're going to continuously try to educate our parents against doing that. TMD problems here in this study. TMD was associated with a posterior crossbite and an anterior open bite, class 3 malocclusion, and extreme maxillary overjet. All of those things come from mouth breathing. It's another one, crossbite correction. I think you have this broken down a little bit. Yeah. Treatment of a unilateral posterior crossbite in the primary dentition improves facial symmetry and increases the palatal surface area. So when we were talking earlier about how the palate is so small and how we need the tongue involved and how we need the mouth to be closed and all that other thing, it proves itself out here. So when we start dealing with these children at 3 years old instead of 7 years old, we have a much better chance of having a much improved face and airway. There's a company called Myo Research from Australia, and they sent somebody up here into the United States maybe 10 years or so, 12 years or so ago, and I met them for the first time at one of the Under One Roof conferences, and he just wanted to be exhibiting. I'm like, the thing is already happening. How are you going to get a table now? Oh, can I just put it in the hall? And so anyway, whatever. And so through the following months, we corresponded a little bit more, and he kept saying, well, you wear this appliance and the kids' faces look better. And I'm like, you can't say that here. Everybody's kid is perfect. You can't tell them that their kid is ugly. Or you can't expect a dental hygienist or a dentist to say, your kid's face really needs improvement. I mean, there's just no way to really say that. So we're getting closer to that right now. It's a little bit easier. We can say, you know, generic terms like a good-looking face is one with the mouth closed and all these other features happening. So this was a study here with chronic fatigue syndrome and sleep apnea, but they weren't able to really make a good tie with that one. I still think that there's a correlation somehow there. I think that this fat phobia thing is really causing a lot of this these problems like fibromyalgia and a lot of other nervous disorders. Babies can sleep with their mouth closed. I didn't know that. All my kids had their pie hole wide open. I didn't realize that they were struggling for air. I just thought it was normal. I did not know that kids could sleep with their mouth closed, but they can. There was an orthodontist in our airway dentistry group. We have a little internet group, and she sent in pictures of her infant with his mouth taped shut. I'm like, I'm not doing that. So we see that we've got exercises that are very helpful in reducing sleep apnea, and this meta-analysis we already kind of went over. This is what the orthotropics can do. You can see the airway here is not horrible, but it's not very big, and look how much bigger it is here. So just by opening that tooth extracted space, they're able to gain some space and let the tongue live where the tongue is supposed to live. This is Dr. Mew again, and civilization is what he's saying is the cause of malocclusion. It was really odd to listen to Dr. Kevin Boyd say that there's a reason for malocclusion and what's happened to cause malocclusion. So, Linda, would you like to say what's happened legislatively?
Oh, I would love to.
Yeah, why don't you?
I hope most of you already know that there is legislation going through the Wisconsin legislature. There are many things I want to make sure everybody in the room understands what it's not, and then also what it is, what it actually does. So I wrote some things down.
Oh, good.
There it is, right there. It's not a mid-level practitioner. It's not about dental therapy. It's also, it does not expand the scope of practice for dental hygienists. So in other words, what your scope is right now is staying exactly the same. It's not adding anything to the scope. It's not going to disconnect us from dentistry at all. If anybody thinks that, make sure that you correct them. It doesn't do that. And it also does not require dental hygienists to have a collaborative agreement, which becomes a limitation. So what it does do is it increases the number of healthcare settings where you can practice dental hygiene. It allows you to practice your scope under your own authority. So you can look at a patient and you can say, I do my assessments and I determine that the patient needs a cleaning, needs fluoride treatment, needs the dental hygiene scope. If they need something other than the things that you can provide, what will you do? You'll make sure that they get connected to a dentist elsewhere, because you do not need to have a dentist supervising you in those other settings. That's the requirement right now. In order for a dental hygienist to practice, they have to have some sort of, right now, a dentist needs to supervise you and tell you what to do. Please laugh when I say that. Because they did the exam, they determined the needs of the patient, and then they authorize you to go ahead and do it. So those restrictions and restraints on practicing are being removed. The support for this bill is nothing short of amazing to me. The Dental Association has signed off. They didn't testify in favor of it, but they did submit written approval or authorization of support.
They agreed with it. They just didn't disagree.
They did not disagree.
We're good with
that.
Wisconsin
Hospital Association is in favor of it. The Wisconsin Hospital Association wants to see dental hygienists employed in their hospitals. Aging advocacy want to see dental hygienists in nursing homes. People who take care of persons with disabilities, developmental disabilities, group homes, and they provide some sort of health care in the group home or daycare centers, including adult daycare centers. They want to have dental hygiene services available to their clientele. That's what it does. It releases dental hygienists from restrictive supervision requirements. I never heard a single word of complaint or concern, and we've talked to a lot of people. So anyway, I hope this makes you happy. If you have any questions about it, I hope that you'll contact me or Debbie, Megan. We all worked really hard on this.
Thank you.
It's a new day for dental hygiene, and especially because we think that we can get to more people who, at this point, have been, we've turned our backs to them, and we haven't been allowed to take care of them. So that was the theme. The legislators went, why would we say no to that?
You should not say no to that.
Question, so would we be able to see patients if they haven't had an exam within the year then? So then we'd be able to say,
that's one of the restrictions.
But there are some suspicious areas that we need you to see.
You have findings. When a dental hygienist does their assessment, they look at the condition of the mouth. If there are findings that you or anybody would recommend that they see a dentist, you can tell the patient, you need to tell the patient. You need to see a dentist. I see something, and I don't want to get into an argument with anybody, but when I first started practicing dental hygiene, which was 48 years ago, I was told, it's okay to call it a bad brownie, but you shouldn't call it a cavity, because that would be diagnosing. So I'm not kidding. I was told that I could tell my patients they had bad brownies, but it's suspicious. But anyway.
So Linda, the way that you described it made it sound as though we could open our own practice.
Yeah. No.
Okay, I'm going to make sure. Right. Somebody else just heard it that way too.
Okay. You would be employed or working with another healthcare system besides dental practices. It does not give permission to start practicing out of your garage or have your spare bedroom turned into a little dental clinic. No.
But as a provider, we could go and just say, say, I'm offering this.
Yes.
So
would you be paid by the nursing home, or would you charge the medical assistants?
We don't know all of those details, but removing this restriction allows you to start to explore how would you get paid. Right now, you can be a Medicaid provider. You can also, right now, bill insurance companies if they have dental insurance, and you can also, bill them patients directly. You could do that right now. So let's assume that that we're going to have nursing homes, hospitals. I think that there's many ways that it can work, not just one. So they may employ you the same way a dental practice employs you, let's say in a hospital, and they submit the claims and then collect the fees. And then, but they pay you, like, whatever. There's many ways that it can.
I know this isn't totally done yet, but like what Sarah said, as far as the 1 year, like if somebody's been a year and a half since they've had an exam, we can still see them.
You can still see them.
There's
no requirement for the for them to have an exam by a dentist first. That's the thing that's
even
going
in our clinical practice.
Not in your dental clinic. That's the one place where they they're not removing that.
Okay.
So that's a little technicality.
I was like, I thought that it didn't count.
And we didn't feel that that was our issue to address.
Okay.
If the dentists want to eliminate that requirement for in their own practices, in their businesses, they will address that with the legislature.
Okay.
And I hate to predict, but I think that's at least a possibility that they will say, hey, you know,
I had another hygienist ask me. That's why I'm clarifying, because I was like, I think it's only in nursing homes and hospitals, but
these
I wanted to make
settings.
Sure. Okay. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Okay. So I'm going to leave some papers back in there. I have a copy of the bill, which frankly, if you read it, most people will go, I don't know, it doesn't want to, because it doesn't directly talk to what I just did. And then I have kind of a fact sheet. I have some papers here if you want to take one home. And I think my contact information is on there too, so that if you have any questions, I don't know if you have any more questions.
Thank you.
So there's like no more action that we have to take at this point,
correct?
I would contact your legislators and tell them thank you, because so far everybody's been in support.
So it passed the House? Is that right? So now we're waiting?
Okay, so there's like many steps. The first step was we got authors from both sides of the aisle, like Democrats and Republicans, both senators and assembly people, signed on, and there were actually two bills, one in the assembly and one in the Senate. The assembly health committee did their hearing, and then they voted unanimously to pass it through that committee. And like it was days later, it went to the full assembly and it was passed unanimously in the assembly. The next step was it went to the Senate Health Committee, or Senate Committee on Health and Human Services. We gave testimony there. They passed it from the that Senate Committee unanimously also. And the next step will be for it to pass the Senate. Once it passes the full Senate, when we think that will happen the first week in May, then I believe at that point the two bills are combined, but they're identical.
Sure.
And then it goes to the governor's desk and the governor signs.
All
right.
Thanks
again. Yeah. Super exciting.
Gonna walk right in front of you.
Why don't you walk right here? Because it's a It's been a long, hard road. So, speaking of money, that's the kind of thing that's really going to allow money to start coming around. People are going to be able to save their money. People are going to be able to do other things with their money other than just chasing down health concerns. And we know that prevention doesn't cost anything. So when we see our patient, we teach them how to use their facial muscles. We go through a bunch of different exercises where they use their muscles like we did with the cracker exercise. There's some exercises that we do to help them chew and help them eat. And in all cases, we work with the back of the tongue to open up their airway. We see a lot of our patients virtually. And when I get the information from the orthodontist, as I mentioned earlier, I'm always looking at the airway and how this neck is so out of whack, okay? And then I recommend that they see their chiropractor. I think that if dentists would look 2 centimeters back and chiropractors would look 2 centimeters forward, we'd all be much healthier. We'd all be better off. Now, from a dental hygiene perspective, this is the kind of thing that I'm now seeing that I didn't see before. So I'm looking at this health history, I'm like, migraines, huh? headaches, huh, GI disorders, huh. Then I look at her dental history, I'm like, geez, wait, what is happening here? There is a complete disconnect between these two situations on the same person. Tongue tie. Her tongue was tied. It was not functioning almost at all. So for a youngish woman, all of this stuff was, I mean, how many root canals do you need in your whole life? This is looking at the little picture, and then we should be looking over here at the big picture. These are, this is my patient again, and I want to just talk about this video right here.
When a lot of people hear that this is about exercises for the face, they think of pain and no pain, no gain. And backing off is not something that they're used to, I don't think.
Right, no, we're all told to keep pushing through.
To push through, and that's not how the gains are happening right now for you.
No, not at all.
I have a little boy in New York State who has low tone in his whole body, but in his face, everything kind of hangs. And so, you know, and his mom's like, oh my God, it's not working, and all this stuff. And I'm like, okay, we're not going to keep pushing through to make him be hating all of this. We're going to keep backing off to see what little minor part it is going to work with and work up to normal, and then we'll build on it when he's ready, when his muscles are ready. So he's got some kind of a disorder where he, stimulation disorder, you know, a lot of these kind of kids have that. But she says he'll stand and bounce, like watching TV for half an hour. And so his calves are really overdeveloped for his six-year-old kid. And I'm like, okay, so he can develop his muscle. This isn't just a state where he has to stay. So we've just been backing off, and she's been really frustrated, and I'm like ecstatic over the changes that he is making. But I know that she has a lot to do with it. You know, she's encouraging and pushing. But I'm trying to give her permission to go backwards instead of just keep pushing forward at whatever Shirley said, you know.
And that is so opposite of everything you ever, you know, we all ever do to try and change a behavior, change anything. It's usually push, not useful. And her backing off is working for me perfectly. You can tell her my story.
Yeah. Well.
Yeah.
Exactly. So that's really, really important to also relay to other people that we're not here to hurt your face, or you're not going to be able to eat for a day, like when you do a bunch of pull-ups or something.
Right, yeah.
You can't use your arms or...
Yeah, really.
So, that's the kind of treatment that we do, and I appreciate your time and getting them to speed on all of this stuff. And the name Primal Air comes from going backwards in order to go forwards. Our goal is to get people to breathe like they did back in primal times, where clothing was optional. Have a great rest of the night.